Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and in today's session we'll be talking about the Financial Stability Report. So this is not going to be a conventional RBI 247 session where we pick up some financial topics and we discuss them with the help of questions. We are not going to cover the questions today, but we'll be discussing the Financial Stability Report in detail. So it's a biannual report which has recently been released by RBI, and it is very important to know about the financial stability, to know about the resilience of our financial system. So that's why I have picked up this report. It's important for your RBI exams, for your interview of RBI as well. So let us discuss this in detail. Talking about this report, it has been structured in a certain manner. So the report begins with your RBI governor's viewpoint. Then it has three important sections where it talks about different risks which are associated with the system, the macro financial risks which exist. Second section talks about the financial institutions, how sound they are, how resilient they are. And the third section talks about the regulatory initiatives which have been taken. So our session will be also on that similar structure, where we'll first begin with the RBI governor's viewpoint. So before beginning up with the report, for all those who are watching this session for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon so that you can get all the latest updates for our upcoming videos. You can also join our Telegram group wherein we share some free quizzes as well as the updates for all our latest videos. So now let's get started with the report. The very first thing which you must know is, what is a financial stability report? So this is a report which is published biannually, okay? And what does it reflect? It basically shows the assessment of the financial stability and the resilience of your financial system. So how strong is your financial system? What are the risks to your financial stability with respect to our financial system? All that is discussed in this report, and it is an assessment of the financial system by subcommittee of the Financial Stability and Development Council. So this is the council which is a non-statutory apex council, and it works under the Ministry of Finance. And the basic objective of this council is to have some mechanism to maintain the financial stability, to strengthen the financial stability. So it takes up different actions in order to make sure the financial stability. So it ensures the regulatory coordination, promotes the development of the financial sector. So this very council carries out an assessment of our financial system, and that assessment is reflected in this very report. This report also discusses the issues which relate to the development and the regulation of our financial sector. So what are the different risks associated with our financial sector? How well is it doing? It states these different ratios which help you get an idea about the financial system's stability. So this is all about the report. That what does this report mean? Now going on to the RBI governor's viewpoint. So this is the 23rd issue of this report. Okay, so let us see what RBI governor has to say about our financial system. So when this report is prepared, the governor's viewpoint is also shared in the beginning. So what our governor has to say? The RBI governor says that the global financial system has so far largely withstood the shocks from the wave of COVID, and the government, central banks and financial regulators have mounted a defense to mitigate the impact of pandemic. So hamara jo global financial system hai, not only that of India but the global financial systems, if we talk about that, they have been able to deal with COVID, okay, especially when it comes to maintaining financial stability. Hamari stability, financial stability maintain ho pai hai kyun? Kyunki government ka, central banks ka, financial regulators ka bahut support raha hai. We have also seen it with respect to India that RBI has been taking steps time to time, SEBI has been taking steps, government is providing the support, World Bank is also providing the support. So worldwide, the governments, the central banks, the financial regulators have been providing the support to their respective nations and also to other nations as well. That is why the financial systems have been able to withstand the shocks of the wave of COVID. By and large, the policy responses have contained the severity of the pandemic's toll on the financial markets and institutions. एंड हैज क्वेश्चन्ड द शॉक टू द इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी. अगर ये पॉलिसी रिस्पॉन्सेज ना लिए गए होते गवर्नमेंट के एंड पे, सेंट्रल बैंक्स के एंड पे, तो पैंडमिक का फाइनेंशियल मार्केट्स पे और सीवियर इम्पैक्ट हो सकता था. बट बिकॉज दीज पॉलिसी रिस्पॉन्सेज हैव बीन टेकन, दैट्स वाई आर इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी हैज बीन क्वेश्चन्ड टू सर्टेन एक्सटेंट एंड द फाइनेंशियल मार्केट्स हैव नॉट दैट सीवियरली बीन इम्पैक्टेड दैन इट वॉज एक्सपेक्टेड. ओके, with vaccination drives and access being ramped up, recovery is gaining ground under the protective cover of policy support. So there is a positive news of the vaccines, and then there are actions taken by the governments, the central banks, in the form of different policy support measures. So both of these things together are making our financial system more stronger. The dent on the balance sheets and the performance of financial institutions in India has been much less than it was projected earlier. Although a clearer picture will emerge as the effects of regulatory reliefs fully work through their way. तो अभी जो हमने प्रोजेक्ट किया था उतना ज़्यादा हमारे बैंक्स की, हमारे फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशंस की बैलेंस शीट अफेक्ट नहीं हुई है, इतनी ज़्यादा उनकी परफॉर्मेंस नेगेटिवली इम्पैक्ट नहीं हुई है, ऑब्वियसली बिकॉज ऑफ द सपोर्ट विच हैज़ बीन देयर फ्रॉम द गवर्नमेंट एंड द सेंट्रल बैंक्स एंड. बट द ट्रू पिक्चर विल कम वेन दीज रेगुलेटरी रिलीफ मेजर्स आर टेकन अवे. ये जो भी रिलीफ मेजर्स दिए गए थे जब इनको हटाया जाएगा, जब ये ईजिंग वाली पॉलिसीज जो हैं उनको हटाया जाएगा, तब असली पिक्चर सामने आएगी कि कितना ज़्यादा हमारा फाइनेंशियल सिस्टम उससे नेगेटिवली इम्पैक्ट हो सकता है. अभी हम देख रहे हैं इंडिया में भी मॉनेटरी पॉलिसी बहुत लिबरल है, बहुत फेवरेबल है इन्वायरमेंट जो चल रहा है उसके हिसाब से. तो जब वो मेजर्स थोड़े और स्ट्रिक्ट किए जाएंगे हो सकता है तब फाइनेंशियल सिस्टम नेगेटिवली इम्पैक्ट हो जाए. कैपिटल एंड लिक्विडिटी बफर्स आर reasonably resilient to withstand the future shocks. Okay, if some future shock also comes up, the banks, the financial institutions now have enough capital and liquidity buffers to better deal with such shocks. But the governor also says that there are some emerging risks which might affect the stability of the system, which include the future waves of the pandemic. Okay, then there is a risk of commodity prices rising, inflationary pressures. We are seeing inflation rising. Okay, we have been discussing in different sessions of RBI 247 that WPI is rising, CPI is rising, it was at this much higher. So that pressure of inflation is a major risk. High uncertainty is there, rising incidence of data breaches and cyber attacks. So cyber crime is also growing with the acceptance or adoption of the digital platforms. Now, what should be the policy objective? The policy objective is to maintain and preserve the financial stability. And how that can be achieved? It can be achieved if we take lead in creating conditions which are favorable for economy to recover, when we have strong capital positions, when we work on enhancing our governance, when we make our financial intermediation more efficient, when we meet the financial needs of the productive sectors of the economy, and when the banks, the financial institutions are sound enough. So all these things will help in preserving our financial stability. Now moving on to the very first section of this report, which talks about macro financial risks. So we will discuss both the global position as well as the domestic position, that is with respect to India only. So talking about the global position and some positives about the economy, the first thing is the COVID recovery. So we have the vaccination drives coming up, we have policy measures from the government's end, all these are helping us to recover from COVID, especially from financial viewpoint. Secondly, capital surges. Because of COVID, international business were affected. So FDIs, FPIs, the capital flows were hampered. But now they have begun to improve again. Capital flows have plotted a return to the emerging economies. Capital flows have picked up strongly in the ensuing months as risk appetite returned with positive news of COVID vaccines. So in India also we have seen this rise. Okay, then is the bank's stable positions. So bank has enough cushion because of the regulatory, monetary, fiscal policies. Banks have maintained enough capital, enough buffers, and that has helped banks retain the stable position. So banks have remained relatively unscathed by the pandemic inducted इंड्यूस्ड डिसरप्शन, सो पैंडेमिक की वजह से जो डिसरप्शन हुए हैं उसके बावजूद हमारा बैंकिंग सिस्टम स्टेबल रहा है ग्लोबली. ओके, देन ए स्ट्रॉन्ग बैंकिंग सेक्टर. सो बैंकिंग सिस्टम्स प्री पैंडेमिक कैपिटल एंड लिक्विडिटी बफर्स हैव हेल्प्ड अ लॉट. दे हैव मेड आवर सिस्टम मोर स्ट्रॉन्गर. जो हम पहले से ही कैपिटल बफर्स, लिक्विडिटी बफर्स रख रहे थे, जो बेसल रिक्वायरमेंट के अकॉर्डिंग रख रहे थे, उसने फाइनेंशियल सिस्टम को बहुत हेल्प किया है स्ट्रॉन्ग रखने में. ओके, द बेसल नॉर्म्स विच मैंडेटेड द कैपिटल कीपिंग कैपिटल बफर्स हैज हेल्प्ड अ लॉट. Armed with high levels and quality of capital, better liquidity and more stable funding, banking sector is in a better position to cushion the stocks and absorb the to cushion the shocks and absorb the losses in than in the past. So as compared to past, we are better prepared now to deal with any shock which might come up, because we as a bank have better amount of capital, enough liquidity, enough funding available. Extensive measures taken by the governments, by the central banks, by the prudential authorities to support the economy has also helped to shield the banks from the impact of pandemic. Moving ahead to the bank asset quality. So asset quality has not deteriorated as much as it was expected, but still we have seen a drop in this. Okay, so we'll be covering about what is the asset quality of our bank's assets in India and different countries around the world. Talking about the insurance sector, so the premium collections in with respect to life insurance and health insurance have held up well. And then talking about the mutual fund industry, so it was losing on the ground, but now it has began to regain the ground it lost. So people are now also going on for mutual funds. Now moving ahead to the downside, that is the risks which have basically risks which were there in the global system. So first is the risk of virus spread. Already we are suffering from the virus, and more contagious and lethal variants might emerge. Okay, then is inflation. So, and this is one of the major risks we are facing. Commodity prices are rising, crude, food, base metal prices are rising. There are supply side disruptions. Okay, and if your inflation rises, if your imports become costlier, then the countries won't like to import or import less, which will lead to affect the trade and thus lead to trade losses, especially for low income countries which import a lot. Okay, then is rising debt level. So we are seeing the governments borrowing a lot. Okay, so if more debt is there, then also the risk of default on these debt rises. So that will hamper the stability of your financial system. So government debt has scaled unprecedented levels. Global public debt rose at all-time high due to the pandemic induced decline in government revenue. Pandemic ki wajah se government revenue has declined, and the government still has to spend a lot. So growth oriented policies mein spend karne ke liye paise zyada kharch ho rahe hain aur revenue kam aa raha hai, jis wajah se government have to borrow a lot. Aggregate public and private debt for a sample of 61 countries rose this much in 2020 alone. Okay, so we are facing high debt to GDP ratio. In the last session, I talked about this very ratio, that what is its implication. So you can have a look at that session. So if countries are borrowing a lot, if their debt is more, then the chances that they might default on debts are also high, which might hamper the financial stability. So looming concern is bank sovereign exposure, especially debt GDP ratios rising to the high levels. Then there are also the prospects of rising NPAs. ये डर है कि future में हमारे NPAs बढ़ सकते हैं. Banks face prospects of possible rise in NPAs. Historical experiences have shown that after these recession kind of situations are, NPAs have risen. So we might see a rise in NPA in this very situation as well. Then the aftermath of removal of quantitative easing. जब अभी तो हम quantitative easing type की policy follow कर रहे हैं, interest rates, we are following this kind of a policy where interest rates are low, where lot of money supply is injected in the economy, liquidity is being increased. So when these measures will be taken away, then it can hamper our फाइनेंशियल सिस्टम. अभी तो लिबरल पॉलिसीज चल रही है, बट जब स्ट्रिक्ट होने लगेंगी ये पॉलिसी तो हो सकता है उसका नेगेटिव इम्पैक्ट हो जाएगा. ओके, सो टेंशंस आर बिल्डिंग बिटवीन पॉलिसी अथॉरिटीज एंड मार्केट्स ऑन द टाइमिंग एंड पेस ऑफ नॉर्मलाइजिंग दीज काइंड ऑफ पॉलिसी. ओके, विच माइट with later anticipating that inflationary pressures will force the hand of authorities. So inflation की वजह से हमें ये policy जो ease हो रही है उसको remove करना पड़ेगा, strict policy लानी पड़ेगी और उसकी वजह से हमारी financial stability affect हो सकती है. Then there are some other challenges also like cyber attacks, then the increased competition from the entry of fintechs, growing big tech firms in financial services. So other than banks and financial institutions, if big technology firms like Amazon, like WhatsApp, Facebook, if these also enter the financial markets and they are not that much regulated as your banks or financial institutions would be, then that might also hamper the stability of our system. Okay. And then talking about asset quality of banks, so the defaults have risen on the loan, the credit defaults have increased. The banks in India have seen worse deterioration in asset quality vis-a-vis other economies. Okay, while all economies saw increase in the default rates, जो भी आपके corporate loans हैं, borrower, जो retail loans हैं, corporate borrowers, retail borrowers all have defaulted, but this default rate is high in India vis-a-vis other nations. This was about the global risks. Now talking about the domestic position, that is the position of India in this regard. So first is public finances. So we have seen a loss in the tax revenue, but the expenses of the government have increased, social measures and fiscal stimulus towards this. So because of the pandemic, we have to incur a lot of expenditure, but the government is not generating revenue, because of which the public debts are building up. Okay. In the absence of robust demand for credit, banks' holdings of your SLRs, of your government securities, of your state development loans, they have stood at the highest levels since March 2010. So, hamari debt bahut zyada hoti ja rahi hai. This is one of the important aspects about our economy. Then is the position of the corporate sector. So, various ups and downs are being faced in our corporate sector. So, talking a bit about that, after nose diving in the first half year due to pandemic related restrictions, private corporate activity revived during the second half year after opening of the economy. So pehle half of the year mein hamari economy kafi down ja rahi thi, corporate sector down ja raha tha, but jab se economy ke different sectors wapas open back hone lage, tab se thoda improvement dikha hai. IT companies have got a lot of support, so they have remained on an expansion zone. Digital platforms have been adopted during this pandemic, because of which IT companies have seen a big boost. Throughout the pandemic period, they recorded 6.5% growth in sales during the fourth quarter. Then the non-IT services sector recorded a maximum contraction during pandemic, but it has also witnessing signs of recovery now. So we are seeing a recovery with respect to the corporate sector. Then talking about the position of the external sector. So because of the pandemic, the export imports were hampered. Okay. But despite the adverse impact of COVID, India received strong interest from foreign portfolio investors. We have seen FPIs rising in India to the record high levels. I have also taken a session on this very topic where FPI in India was at a peak. So India's stable financial market conditions, favorable economic prospects, easy liquidity conditions are making sure that FPIs come to your nation. After a surplus in current account balance, we are now seeing a deficit. So current account, if it's seeing a deficit, that means your imports and exports are happening, which are impacting this deficit. Okay, so the economies have opened up, because of which our trade deficit is widening and there is increase in the net investment income. So export import ho raha hai, investments ho rahi hai, FPI investments, jiski wajah se hamara balance sheet mein, balance of payments mein bhi effect dikh raha hai. So that means we are now more open when it comes to external sector. There was increase in foreign exchange reserves. We also discussed about this in one of the sessions, that they were at record high levels, and if you have enough reserves, that can act as a cushion against global spillovers. So India's merchandise exports and imports contracted during 2020-21 because of the recessionary conditions and the collapse in the world trade, but external trade has witnessed a rebound in growth since third quarter, बट स्टिल देयर आर कंसर्न्स बिकॉज ऑफ द पैंडेमिक. तो हमारा एक्सटर्नल ट्रेड वापस इम्प्रूव होना शुरू हुआ है, जो जिसमें हमें डाउनफॉल देखी थी थोड़े टाइम पहले. नेक्स्ट इज द बैंकिंग स्टेबिलिटी. सो बैंकिंग स्टेबिलिटी इंडिकेटर इज समथिंग विच यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड ओवर हियर. सो बैंकिंग स्टेबिलिटी इंडिकेटर, वॉट डज इट प्रेजेंट? इट प्रेजेंट्स एन असेसमेंट ऑफ द चेंजेस इन अंडरलाइंग कंडीशंस एंड रिस्क that have bearing on the stability of banking sector. So because of various changes which are happening, how much strong is your banking system? Assessing that can be done using different ratios. Okay, so different ratios are there to check the soundness of the banks, the asset quality, the profitability, the liquidity, the efficiency. So these five dimensions are checked using these ratios which have been mentioned, like CRAR, then your CRAR, net NPA ratios, return on assets, and all of these. So using these indicators, you can assess how sound are your banks. Okay. So the banking stability indicator of the scheduled commercial banks, what did it show? That we have improved in all these aspects, and especially when it comes to soundness, profitability, and liquidity. And how is it possible that we are so strong when it comes to all this? It's because of reduction in risk, as banks have enough capital positions, more customer deposits, better return on assets. So banks have maintained enough capital. It has seen enough rise in the deposits from the customers, and thus has been able to maintain the stability. So moving ahead to bank credit. So this sector has not done very well. Okay, if we come to bank credit, the environment for bank credit remains lackluster in the midst of pandemic. Credit supply muted by risk aversion and subdued loan demand. Log loans ki demand hi nahi kar rahe the. Hum repay nahi kar payenge is to unko risk taking ability hi nahi thi ki wo loan le. So bank credit has not grown that much as it should have been. Okay. Then bank credit to MSME sector, if I talk about that, so we have seen some growth in it, and that growth was aided by this scheme ECLGS, Emergency Credit Line Guarantee Scheme, which helps provide collateral free loans, government guaranteed loans to your MSMEs. So public sector banks credit to this sector has remained flat. Okay, and private sector banks has shown some increase. Further, the weakness which was there in MSME sector has been addressed by RBI, and RBI has been taking restructuring, has been undertaking restructuring with respect to this MSME sector. Despite restructuring, stress still remains in the MSME sector. All right. Now moving ahead to the liquidity risk. So liquidity in banking system remained in large surplus. Liquidity risk itni zyada nahi hai, hamara banking sector strong enough hai, unke paas enough capital, enough funding available hai. Then talking about consumer credit. So consumer credit includes your home loans, loans for property, auto loans, vehicle loans, so all these kinds of loans, educational loans which we usually take. So overall demand has stabilized after third quarter onwards. So pehle itni demand nahi thi, but thodi si stabilize hui because of festive demand from third quarter onwards. But the second wave again affected the credit demand, and we have seen a steep fall in people inquiring about more credit facility now. Next is bank asset quality. So I have already told you that banks in India have seen worst deterioration in asset quality due to pandemic. So let's talk a bit about this. While all countries saw a year-on-year increase in the default rates, so we have seen an increase in the default rates among both corporate and retail borrowers during the fourth quarter, it has been more pronounced in case of India. So hame default rates bade hain, bhale hi wo corporates ne loans liye ho या फिर वो रिटेल लोन्स क्यों ना हो, सब में डिफॉल्ट रेट्स बढ़े हैं. बट दैट डिफॉल्ट रेट हैज बीन रियली वेरी हाई व्हेन इट कम्स टू इंडिया. द रिपोर्ट कुलेटेड डिफॉल्ट रेट्स इन रिटेल एंड कॉर्पोरेट पोर्टफोलियो ऑफ बैंक अक्रॉस 7 मेजर इकोनॉमीज. सो इस रिपोर्ट में 7 मेजर इकोनॉमीज का असेसमेंट किया गया था, उनका डिफॉल्ट रेट जो है वो असेस किया गया है 7 इकोनॉमीज का. अकॉर्डिंग टू द रिपोर्ट, द डिफॉल्ट रेट इन इंडिया इज मोर देन दैट ऑफ US. And European banks have in fact improved on their default rates. But India has done worse. And if I talk about the major sector in India, which is contributing to this default. So portfolio, corporate portfolio mein jo defaults ho rahe hain, the major defaults in the corporate portfolios was because of the small and medium enterprises. And retail loans were affected due to the pandemic and other restrictions led to job losses, decline in loan payments. Lockdown ki wajah se logs ki jobs ja rahe hain, unko jobs nahi mil rahi, unke paas paisa nahi hai repay karne ko, jis wajah se retail loans mein bhi defaults ho rahe hain. So the performance of Indian retail portfolio deteriorated in 5 out of the 7. The performance of retail portfolio deteriorated in 5 out of the 7 countries, with India seeing the sharpest increase in default rate. So India mein retail portfolio mein sharpest jo hai wo increase dikha hai hame default rates mein. India aisa kyun hua hai? Indian retail borrowers were worst impacted compared to other nations due to poor fiscal support. So UK jaisi countries ne kya kiya hai, unke yahan agar jaise logon ko lockdown ki wajah se jobs nahi milti to kuch percent of wages around 80% government pay kar rahi hai ya un employers ko pay karne mein help kar rahe hai jo apne employees ko payments nahi kar pa rahe. But India mein kya hai, India mein humne moratorium de diya, thoda time extra de diya, aise wages support itna zyada India mein nahi mila hai. Agar mila होता तो हो सकता है हमारा इतना ज़्यादा retail loans में defaults ना होते. Okay, so this is the example which I am discussing, that the UK government has came up with a scheme where 80% of the wages were granted to employees if the employers were unable to pay. So we are on our part of providing moratoriums, but such kind of schemes we are not able to provide, because of which our retail sector has seen a high rate of default. Okay. Now talking about another thing, which is the systemic risk survey. So what are the different risks in the system? A survey was done. Okay, different global risk, macroeconomic risk, financial market risk, institutional risk, general risks. And on all these risks, we have remained on a medium scale, means we are having medium level of risk, not too high, neither too high, neither too low. Okay, neither too high nor too low. And talking about the risks which are in high risk category, so these are the risks where we are having really high levels. वैसे तो हमारा risk system medium level पे है, लेकिन कुछ risks हैं जो बहुत high level पे हैं, जिन्हें हमें immediately उनके against कुछ actions लेके उन्हें maintain करना होगा. So they include your commodity price risk, domestic growth, inflation risk, fiscal deficit risk, corporate vulnerabilities, price volatility, credit growth, banks asset quality, capital requirement, cyber risk. So ye kafi high hai humare. We have to work on these. Okay, now moving ahead to the next section. So we discussed about macro financial risks. Second section of this report deals with the soundness and the resilience of the financial institutions. So initial assessment of the major central banks is that banks' financial positions have supported well. There has been no significant rise in the non-performing loans. Policy support packages have helped maintain the solvency. Bank's performance and balance sheet has turned out to be better than it was anticipated. So hamari position achhi rahi hai, itne zyada hamare non-performing loans nahi hue hain, itni zyada hum log strong enough rahe hain when it comes to solvency, when it comes to liquidity, and the government policies have also supported a lot. But still the downside remains, and the stress, because there are stress signals emerging out. So talking about different areas of scheduled commercial banks. So agar hum scheduled commercial banks ki performance ko assess kare, to credit growth hamari bahut achhi nahi rahi hai. We have a tepid bank credit growth, that is not very strong growth because of the lockdowns. So next is deposits growth. Deposits mein hame growth dikhi hai, hum logon ne bahut zyada paisa banks mein jama kiya hai as a precautionary savings measure due to pandemic. So deposits growth maintained upward trajectory, with current account and savings account deposits increasing. Then we talk about asset quality and capital adequacy. So we have been discussing about CRAR, how much capital you must maintain against the risk weighted assets. So bank needs to maintain this ratio. So this ratio has improved. That means banks are maintaining enough capital against their risky assets. It's reached to 16%. And the gross NPA and the net NPA ratios have remained stable. Hamara NPA na hi bada hai bahut zyada, na hi kam hua hai, stable raha hai 7.5 and 2.4 pe. So GNPA and NNPA. First of all, NPA stands for our non-performing assets. Okay, if your loans are in default beyond a certain time period, then they are classified as an NPA. So that absolute amount is the GNPA, gross NPA. Okay, but so it's the total value of your gross NPAs for bank in particular quarter or financial year. But what is net NPA? When you are deducting the provisions for these NPAs from the absolute amount, that becomes your NNPA. So aap NPAs ke saath deal karne ke liye kuch provision rakhoge. So jab aap wo provision ko deduct karte ho gross amount se, to aapko net NPA mil jata hai. It subtracts the provisions made by bank from gross NPA. Therefore, it gives the exact value of NPAs after bank has made specific provisions for it. So this these are the terms which you must know. Next ratio is the provisioning coverage ratio. So that has increased. What is this ratio? It refers to the prescribed percentage of funds to be set aside by banks to cover prospective losses due to bad loans. Bad loans होने की वजह से banks को losses हो सकते हैं. तो banks पहले ही कुछ funds set aside करके रखते हैं as a provision to deal with that situation. So वो ratio improve हुआ है. मतलब हमारे banks जो हैं उन्होंने enough provisions maintain किए हैं to deal with such situations. So this was about scheduled commercial banks. Talking about NBFCs, we have seen credit growth. Credit extended by NBFCs has risen and the gross NPAs have declined. Okay, because there was high provisioning, there was capital adequacy. But still, if I talk about one sector under NBFC which has seen a stress, that is the NBFC MFI, the microfinance institution. So there, the asset quality stress has increased, their gross NPA has ballooned, and the decline in the collection efficiency can impact their liquidity position as well. Okay, so now talking about macro stress tests. So under this report, some macro tests were conducted, and accordingly, what can be the future prospects, that has also been provided in this report. So test karaye gaye jiski wajah se pata chala hai ki kya aage aane wali position ho sakti hai banks ki. So you must be clear about the meaning of stress tests. Stress test is an analysis conducted under hypothetical scenarios designed to determine whether a bank has enough capital to withstand the negative economic shocks. Like you do a mock test to assess where you are lacking, which areas you are strong. Exam se pehle aap mock test dete ho, jisse aapko pata lagega ki yahan hum strong enough nahi hai, hume is area mein work karne ki zarurat hai. To aapko idea lag jayega ki asli situation jab aayegi exam ki, to aap uske according kahan stand karte ho. Aise hi banks ka jab mock test diya jata hai, wo stress test hai, jahan pe aap hypothetical situations create karte ho ki ye risk hai, credit risk hai, market risk hai, liquidity risk hai, aur recession ki situation hai, ya financial मार्केट क्रैश हो गई, तो उसका इंपैक्ट बैंक्स पे क्या होगा वो असेस करते हो आप. सो दैट इज अ स्ट्रेस टेस्ट. ओके, सिनेरियोस क्रिएटेड हियर इंक्लूड अनफेवरेबल सिचुएशंस लाइक रिसेशन, फाइनेंशियल मार्केट क्रैश, एंड यू अकाउंट फॉर क्रेडिट रिस्क, मार्केट रिस्क, लिक्विडिटी रिस्क एंड ऑल. सो व्हाट हैव दीस टेस्ट शोन? फर्स्ट, दे हैव शोन दैट आवर एनपीएस कैन राइज. Macro stress test for credit risk show that the scheduled commercial banks GNPA may increase from 7.48 to 9.8 under baseline scenario and to 11.22 under stress scenario. So baseline scenario means a steady state of values of macroeconomic variables. Jo hamare macroeconomic variables hain like GDP growth, CPI, weighted average lending rate and many other indicators, ye agar steady value pe rahe, jaise abhi hain steady rates pe rahenge, तो हमारा ग्रॉस एनपीए इंक्रीज होके 9.80 तक जा सकता है मार्च 2022 में. लेकिन अगर और कोई सीवियर स्ट्रेस सिनेरियो आ जाएगा तो ये और ज़्यादा भी राइज कर सकता है, ये हमारा स्ट्रेस टेस्ट ने कहा है. तो फ्यूचर में एनपीए राइज होने के चांसेस हैं अकॉर्डिंग टू द स्ट्रेस टेस्ट रिजल्ट्स. देन टॉकिंग अबाउट कॉमन इक्विटी टियर वन कैपिटल रेशियो. So what is this ratio? It shows how much core capital a bank holds in its structure. कितनी आपकी core capital है जिसमें आपकी equity capital, disclosed reserves, retained earnings ये सब आ जाएंगी. Okay, so you maintain certain tier 1 capital, tier 2 capital. We have been discussing about this in Basel. Okay, so said capital 1 includes your core capital, and that ratio might decline for scheduled commercial banks under a baseline scenario and a more under stress scenario. So they may decline from 12.78 to 12.58 under baseline and to 10.73 under severe stress scenario. but still it will remain in such a position that minimum threshold is not affected. Okay, minimum jitna remain retain karna hai utna to hum kar hi lenge severe stress scenario mein bhi. Then is we have sufficient capital. So stress tests also indicate that the scheduled commercial banks have sufficient capital. So severe stress scenario bhi aa jayega tab bhi banks ke paas enough capital rahegi. Banks ke paas enough CRAR bhi maintained rahega bhale hi worst scenario ki na aa jaye wo minimum percent se upar tak ka CRAR bhi maintain kar payenge. So we'll be able to maintain enough capital, we will be able to maintain the regulatory minimum of 9% of CRAR as well. Now talking about the next thing after macro stress test is the network of financial system. Our financial system has different financial institutions and the exposures which they have. So a bank say koi financial institution borrow kar sakti hai, kisi aur jagah pe money market mein capital market mein wo invest kar sakti hai. So there is interlinkages between different financial institutions, between banks. Financial network with financial institutions as nodes and bilateral exposures as links provide opportunities for investment, risk diversification, sourcing of fund and liquidity management. So alag alag jagah ek institution invest kar sakti hai, alag alag jagah se wo loans le sakti hai. At the same time, however, the network exposes its constituents to negative externalities, spillovers and spillbacks. अगर आप एक दूसरे में invest कर रहे हो, एक दूसरे से loans लिए हैं, तो अगर एक कोई organization affect होगी, तो उससे बाकी भी impact होंगे, okay? Spillover effect होगा. If a financial institution is impacted and it has taken loan from the bank, then the banks will also get affected. So bilateral exposures are nothing but being exposed to the entities of same sector. So from same sector, you are taking some loans, you are making some investments. So that is a bilateral exposure. And in these bilateral exposures, scheduled commercial banks have large exposures. So in key investments, dusri jagah bahut zyada hai, inhone bahut zyada loans de rakhe hai, inse dusron ne le rakhe hai. That is what they are saying. And the share of asset management companies, mutual funds is also increasing. Talking about inter-sector exposures, where you are investing in different sectors or obtaining loans from different sectors, talking about that, first is the asset management company mutual fund, second is the insurance company. Both of these are the biggest fund providers in the system. And NBFCs and housing finance companies are the ones who are receiving the funds. Okay, so this is about the network of financial system. Now coming to the last section of our report, which talks about the regulatory initiatives which have been taken. So the role of government and regulators, if we talk about the COVID pandemic, has got sustained policy support from the government, central bank and other regulators, as I discussed initially during the session. So the policy actions have been able to mitigate the pandemic related losses and stresses and have cushioned the real activity and preserved the soundness of the financial system. Is support ki wajah se jitna ho sake utna hamara system bacha raha hai, sound raha hai. And the regulatory reforms implemented in the years after global financial crisis enabled banks to enter COVID crisis with sizable liquidity buffers. So global financial crisis ke baad se jo bhi hamari Basel requirements rahi hain, उन बेसल रिक्वायरमेंट्स की वजह से हमने एज अ बैंक इनफ कैपिटल रखी है जिसने अब हमें कोविड टाइम पे हेल्प किया है. सो बेसल रिक्वायरमेंट्स एंड अदर रिक्वायरमेंट्स मैंडेटेड बैंक्स एंड इंस्टीट्यूशंस टू हैव इनफ कैपिटल अवेलेबल व्हिच इज नाउ हेल्पिंग ड्यूरिंग कोविड. द स्विफ्ट एंड एग्रेसिव रिस्पॉन्सेज ऑफ सेंट्रल बैंक्स ईज्ड फाइनेंशियल कंडीशंस एंड लिक्विडिटी रिस्क. इमीडिएटली जो सेंट्रल बैंक ने पॉलिसी चेंजेस किए हैं, हेल्प दी है इकोनॉमी को, उसने बहुत फाइनेंशियल सिस्टम स्ट्रांग रखने में हेल्प किया है. Regulatory easing across jurisdictions facilitated the flow of financial resources to the economy and prevented the amplification of shock. So regulatory easing rahi hai, jitna ho sake utte loans, utti simplified policies aayi hai jisne economy ko kafi help kiya hai. So if I talk about global regulatory developments, various policies measures have been taken to support the economy, like restricting the dividend and bonus payments so that banks have enough capital available, not using them to give away the dividend. Enough dividend na do, bonus payments na do ya kam do taki aapke capital enough rahe, aise changes aaye the policies mein. Then access to low cost financing were available from central banks end. Then there were flexibility in the provisioning standards. There was reduced regulatory capital buffer requirements. There was allowing of the temporary breaches of liquidity coverage ratio. Restructuring allow ki, moratoriums were granted, loan pe guarantees di gayi, फंड दिए गए ताकि फर्दर लेंडिंग की जा सके. सो ऑल दीज एंड मेनी मोर मेजर्स हैव बीन टेकन वर्ल्ड वाइड. Government support measures are expected to remain in place until the economic environment is stable. So हमारे central bank ने भी ये कहा है और बाकी worldwide central banks भी ये कह रहे हैं कि जब तक support चाहिए तब तक हम simple policies रखेंगे और support करेंगे economy को. Then talking about domestic regulatory developments. Now I am not going to discuss these development again. Okay, if you have been following all our RBI 247 sessions, there I have been discussing every new change, every new step taken by RBI or SEBI or government to support your economy due to the pandemic. We have had sessions where specifically RBI came up with some provisions, with some changes to deal with the second wave of COVID. Then what actions were taken before that, after that, all of them have been covered in detail in RBI 247 sessions. Okay, so you can go through them. In order to remind you, I'll just refer to some of them. I'll just mention some of them. Okay, there was resolution framework, if you remember, ECLGS scheme for the MSME sector, bad bank construction hua hai India mein. Okay, NARCL pe humne ek session bhi liya tha. Then centralized payment systems like RTGS were allowed to non-bank entities. This was also covered. Digital payment security controls were issued. So guidelines aati rahi hai time to time, wo humne discuss ki hai. Directions for amalgamations of urban cooperative banks, which are weak urban cooperative bank with strong entities. We have discussed this also in one of the sessions. Other than that, various other liquidity support measures have been taken. The liquidity window has been opened. Loans could have been taken. The monetary policy changes have been made. Okay, the ratios have reduced. Less amount you need to maintain in the form of reserves. And many other steps have been taken. If you are giving credit to MSME, you were allowed a relaxations when it comes to CRR, so and etc. The list is quite long. Many different steps have been taken. So you can, if you have been watching RBI 247 sessions, you will be knowing about that. It's not anything difficult because we have discussed about the regulatory measures taken over time. So that have only been reflected in this report as well. So this was all about the report. So what idea we get about the financial system is that our financial system, both worldwide as well as that of India, is strong enough. It is having enough capital, enough liquidity, stable funding available, and all that has been possible because of government support, central bank support, regulator support, and Basel and other such policies or regulatory frameworks which were already in practice. So already jo aap capital maintain karke rakhi hai, provisions maintain karke rakhe hain, uske saath saath jo ab naya government ka ya central banks ka ya regulator ka support mil raha hai, उसने हमारे फाइनेंशियल सिस्टम को स्ट्रॉन्ग रखा है, रेजिलिएंट रखा है कि हम कोविड से डील कर पाएं और आने वाले स्ट्रेस सिनेरियो में भी हम उससे स्ट्रॉन्गली डील कर पाएंगे अगर ऐसा ही सिस्टम एक चलता रहे. लेकिन कुछ इमर्जिंग रिस्क्स भी हैं जिन्हें हमें एड्रेस करना होगा, जो हमारे लिए आगे आने वाले टाइम में प्रॉब्लम्स क्रिएट कर सकते हैं. सो दिस वॉज ऑल फॉर टुडे सेशन. आई होप दिस सेशन वॉज यूजफुल. इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर योर आरबीआई एग्जाम्स, for your RBI interview as well. Okay, so be aware about the financial stability report and all what this report has to say. So this was a lengthy session because we had to cover this report in detail. So this was all for today's session. Now thank you so much.